Hello, and welcome to this episode of Confessions of a Method Writer. I am Sean Nolan. What we're going to do for this session is actually we're going to talk about a new mini-series about Ridley Scott, the film director. It's going to be called The Duellist. I had come up with this idea upon having seen one of his more recent movies, The Last Duel, and made me kind of think about his first film, The Duelists, and was looking over his filmography and realized that there are some entries that you can find a lot of similar themes to that can be matched together. Some of them are very obvious. Some of them are more deep cuts. Some of them can just be something as simple as the stories are really similar, whereas other ones can be that there are little nuances that are deep within. One of the things I noticed was that there were certain shots that he had imitated and stolen from his first film when doing The Last Duel. Even though they're called The Duelist and The Last Duel, so there's a duel in it, I found that there's these visual touches that he seemed to have kind of, he went back to the well on. So what I was trying to see was what within his oeuvre were things that he had repeated and what could be matched together. And I guess it's something that was, I feel that, a lot of times writers and artists, they tend to, go back to the well on and to find similar themes. I do know that when trying to do things like writing a screenplay, I think I'm always writing the same story. And I know a lot of other people kind of do the same thing. Even though Ridley Scott's not a writer, you can find that the stories that he wants to tell, there can be similarities. There can be themes that he revisits. There can be, just visuals that he will discover and rediscover and then rediscover again, characters that pop back up, different name, different face, almost as if you're auditioning it in one film and it comes back to another. So what we're going to do, I'm going to have a little interlude here with an introduction for the films of Ridley Scott.
I can assure you that the hunting was no choice of mine.
You have insulted me. You have insulted me!
You still don't understand what you're dealing with, do you? Perfect organism.
I've seen things you people wouldn't believe.
Higher, burning fire, making music like a choir.
If you don't do that, someone will come after you. They're gonna find you dead with your face, miss.
Then the heat brought rain. Black rain.
What are you talking about? Let's keep going.
But we find neither gold nor your earthly paradise.
What happened to my ship was not imagined. It was not a dream.
Everything about what happens when you're captured, Lieutenant?
Oh, yeah, just like the men do.
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained?
I'm giving very serious thought. To eating your wife.
We got a Black Hawk down, we got a Black Hawk down.
It's stuffy in here, this place smells like Lysol.
Rise and knight!
rise a knight.
And a bottle of wine that tastes like you. A glass that's never empty.
I got celebrities. I got sports figures. I got Harlem, Richie. I took care of Harlem, so Harlem's gonna take care of me. You can believe that.
Well, I did it, all right? It's done. I killed him.
He was always gonna get killed, no matter what he did.
I declare him, from this day forth, to be an outlaw!
Dalek, if you don't stop it, there won't be any home to go back to.
And spreads herself across the windshield in front of me with no pen to...
These catastrophes are the work of God, and they have not finished.
I'm gonna have to science the shit out of this.
If you created me, who created you?
Miss Getty, we have your son.
Is this some kind of joke?
Jacques Legree entered our home, and he attacked me.
The accusation is false.
I don't consider myself a particularly ethical person, but I am fair.
Welcome back to The Duelist, the films of Ridley Scott. The first pairing, the first duel that I'm going to discuss is his second film, Alien, and the Matt Damon starring vehicle, The Martian. I actually have something very personal to talk about with these two films. And it is a theme about death. In particular, it's about, well, it gets a little deep, and it's about dying alone. And I don't know if anyone has ever seen the movie The Ninth Configuration, but there is a visual in the film when the astronaut is talking about going to space, and he starts having a crisis of faith, and he starts feeling about what would be happen if he had gotten out into space and if he died out there, and what if God didn't exist? Now, to go back on this, what is it like to die alone? Now, in The Ninth Configuration, the image that they have is, you know, an astronaut walking on the surface of the moon as he comes upon a very familiar and identifiable image, particularly in Western culture, which is the crucifixion. It's like Jesus on the cross, crucified on the moon. And I had come upon this when I was watching Interstellar, this thought about dying alone and how it's such a powerful thing. What if you did get somewhere and everybody you knew left you, or they died, and you were left there to exist for a long time, short time, and you had to die without anyone else around? And what if there was no higher power, and you would truly be alone when you died? That's the heavy part. Let's get into the duel. So, Alien, The Martian, both of these films, they have something very interesting in common, which is about the needs of the many over the few. More so in The Martian, but in Alien as well, you can tell this because of the whole conspiracy about how you have the company in Alien, or the government in The Martian, making a decision. And that decision is easily defined as complete your mission and crew expendable. Now, in The Martian, it's more that his crew needs to save themselves, and it is it was a choice for them to have to unfortunately leave Mark to save themselves. In Alien, it is a choice of the evil government, the company, to want to obtain this organism. And the crew is expendable. What does happen in The Martian is that the movie starts off like the opposite of Alien. He's all alone. Whereas in Alien, eventually Ripley is all alone. And what's very powerful is that there can be a great depression and a sense. What happens when you lose faith, when you have lost all hope? You know, it's got to be fucking scary, very terrifying. Being stuck, like, say, being stuck on Mars, all alone. You might get saved, you might not get saved. You might die alone. Or being stuck on the Nostromo, where this 7-foot monster has killed everybody there. And you are all alone. And I only the last couple times have I really appreciated watching Sigourney Weaver's physical performance, how the nerves that are just dripping out of this woman, coming around a corner, you know, coming up the ladder, and, you know, just so nervously looking, because you're alone on this ship with, like, the scariest motherfucker you're probably ever going to meet. And the cat's no help. You know, it is such a foreboding sense of doom that Alien instills in you. Whereas The Martian, I'm going to say a very controversial thing here. The Martian is a hilarious movie. I know it's the butt of jokes year after year about how it won a Golden Globe for best comedy. And I'll admit it's not a comedy, but I'm not really sure what it is. A science fiction or faction humorous dramedy. I'm not really sure, but it's hilarious. The movie is really funny. It's probably one of Ridley Scott's funniest movies. Maybe even more so than something like Matchstick Men. But I think it's a very funny movie. And what's great about it is that's how the survivor of the Martian, Mark Watney, that's how he survives. He survives through his sarcasm and his humor, a way of trying to get past this horrific thing that has happened to him. I guess you just have to be stuck on Mars and just wonder, well, I'm probably going to die, so I might as well just laugh about this, and I'm going to have to grow potatoes using my own shit. Whereas, you know, in Alien, you know, they're always, they make jokes about the food. If anyone listens really closely to the final, the Last Supper that they have before Kane has his chestburster incident, you hear you can actually hear Parker making making an oral sex joke, which when you're younger, that completely goes over your head. I don't know about everybody else. The first time I ever saw Alien was on Channel 11, WPIX, the same channel that used to show Charles Bronson movies at in the afternoon on a Sunday. They always had the best promos for these Charles Bronson movies, because it's always like, the Sunday afternoon, WPIX movie, Charles Bronson, Dash Wish 3. You know, or it would always be some other shitty kind of film. I miss Shocktober. They used to do Shocktober. They used to always show They Live, Christine. Yeah. I was always curious how they showed the ending of They Live on Channel 11. That's got to be a hard one. Anyone who's ever seen They Live, it's got, like, the best ending. Anyway, back to the duel, though. A lot of people might forget that The Martian is Ridley Scott's biggest hit. And rightfully so. I think it's a fantastic movie. And I think it's a film that a lot of people might not pay a lot of attention to, even if they had seen it. I think it's a very deep movie about survival, teamwork, trying to not lose hope. And I think that it gets through that without being like a 2 hour plus sludge because of its humor. On the flip side of that, Alien gets around this whole idea about survival by just fucking surviving. I mean, the way that Ripley just kind of has to think on her toes and goes from being like a side character to, you know, taking the reins and, you know, fighting off egos from everywhere. Yeah, Alien is probably the movie that I've seen the most of any movie. It may be one of my favorite films. I think it's one of my top 10, maybe top 5 favorite movies. It's definitely the movie that I've probably watched the most. And I think I find little things in it all the time. I think it's one of the best composed and shot movies, which, you know, going some, 35 years later, over 35 years later, I think The Martian probably could have been shot badly by somebody who doesn't understand where the camera needs to go to make a movie where, you know, let's say half of it is like a one-man show. It's very impressive. So, you know, my daughter has a lot of thoughts on xenomorphs. So we're gonna close out by kind of listening to some of those. And I guess if I was going to say who wins this duel, this isn't like the Final Four tournament, so it's just one movie kind of up against another. They're both fantastic movies, but I'm thinking Alien wins the duel as far as a movie about survival and what it's like to beat the odds and not dying alone in space or on Mars. So, that's my closing statement on that. And now we're going to listen to some thoughts from my daughter, Ashling, about xenomorphs.
Start with Marjorie. Marjorie, do it. Do that.
Okay, so that is Marguerite Nolan doing her impression of a xenomorph. Right now she has a pillow, like a throw pillow on her head to extend her head to look like a xenomorph. And we are also joined by Marguerite Nolan, Marguerite Nolan and Aisling Nolan. These are my two daughters, and they wanted to talk today about xenomorphs. So why don't you come a little closer? Tell us a little bit about xenomorphs, Aisling.
I think that xenomorphs come from a planet where there's lots of xenomorphs and all sorts of xenomorphs. Yeah. They're all different colors.
What colors do they come in?
They could come in black.
Yeah.
Or red.
Yeah. Where'd you find out about xenomorphs?
I just think that.
What do you think? Like what?
I thought that because I thought that would be a bit silly.
Let me preface this by saying that none of my daughters have seen the Alien films. Okay? So this all comes from their knowledge. Where was the first place you had become aware of a xenomorph?
When I wanted to be an astronaut.
Okay. Tell us about that.
Because astronauts want to find life, and maybe there's a xenomorph out there.
Yeah? What do they look like? Marguerite has run into the room and is now attacking us again with her xenomorph pillow on top of her head.
Oh no! It's the Marguerite xenomorph! I was just dressing up to be a xenomorph.
What do xenomorphs look like?
They have big heads, and they look like robots.
Robots? How do they look like men, or do they look like robots?
They look like both.
Oh, okay. They got big heads?
Yeah, and they don't have eyes.
Oh, okay. You ever seen their tongues?
Their tongues are so scary.
And so you've seen also my the Christmas ornament, right?
Yeah, we have a xenomorph Christmas ornament.
Yeah.
There is Marguerite attacking us again.
We keep having to fight off xenomorph attacks here. What about the book?
We have a book called Jonesy. It's based on the cat, and it doesn't have any words. And one of the parts, Jonesy is the name of the cat. So Jonesy is inside a cage, and the xenomorph comes, and he just stares at his nose.
Is it a cute story or is it scary?
It's a bit cute and it's a bit scary.
Yeah. But you like it?
Yeah, I like it.
Yeah. Do you think xenomorphs are scary or are they cute?
Scary!
Yeah. Do you want to see the movie someday?
Yes!
Yeah? Do you know what the movie is? Like what it's about?
Maybe it's about some astronauts that find a xenomorph.
Yeah? How do they find it?
Maybe they're in their rocket ship
Yeah.
And the xenomorph is out hunting for humans.
Oh.
So he comes in the rocket ship.
And that's how he gets on the ship? He's hunting them?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you think happens in the end?
Maybe the ending is good.
Yeah, like how?
And they use a chemical to get the xenomorph away.
They use a chemical?
Yeah, right. Like in a book.
Yeah. Do they use a chemical in the book?
Yes.
They do? Oh. All right. Again, my daughters have never seen the movie Alien. And Margarita's again coming into the room. Ah! Another attack.
Do your best xenomorph voice. Oh no, she's out hunting for us again!
Marguerite, do you have any closing thoughts about xenomorphs? Okay, well, if there's no other thoughts, what I'm going to do is I'm gonna bring our discussion to a close. And I want to thank Aisling and Marguerite for coming in and talking to us about...
This is my
call. Talking about what they know about xenomorphs. And now back to the podcast. Okay, so we return back to Confessions of a Method Writer Presents... Ridley Scott, The Duelist. Our next duel is going to be between two... this is one of those examples of movies that don't really have a lot in common, but have something that they do share, which might be, I guess, a genre or plot. And that is Matchstick Men and The Counselor. So I'll start off with Matchstick Men. This was the movie that I remember being described in, I think it was Entertainment Weekly, where Ridley Scott was getting ready to prep to do Kingdom of Heaven. So one of the largest films that he had to undertake in many years, along the lines of the scope of something like Gladiator, where... he seemed like he was, the guy in the driver's seat, making a film about the Crusades. And before that, he makes this movie with Nicolas Cage, which is like a heist movie. And it was described in Entertainment Weekly. I think Ridley Scott may have even said it as a quote, is that sometimes a chef will make ham and eggs just to keep themselves in practice before making an elegant meal. So Matchstick Men, I guess, was supposed to be ham and eggs. And it's this film that falls into a certain period of time where Ted Griffin had, hot off of the success of something like Ocean's 11, you had these type of movies where, you could you have very slick dialogue and there's these twists and turns and people backstabbing each other and surprises for the audience, and they're always fun, but I guess maybe they can, in a way. Afterwards, they can kind of become a little empty. Now, I think Matchstick Men is fine. And fine has become an interesting term in my life. A little something about me. I work as a funeral director. And I remember when I was doing my residency, or as some people might call it, like an internship, I would be asked, how is such and such? And use the word fine. Fine is along the lines of saying, I don't fucking care, or blah. It means nothing. It doesn't describe anything. It is empty. So I guess Matchstick Men is entertaining, but a little bit empty. There's things in it that are, you know, that you can love. I mean, it's got Sam Rockwell, and he's always a treat. And it's one of these, like, roles where Nicolas Cage is, you know, doing a little bit of his Cage-isms. At the end of the day, though, I guess it's not really one of these movies that people kind of talk about. And when you talk about Ridley Scott, it's not really one of these movies that people give a shit about. On the flip side of that, I think sometimes some people give too much of a shit about a movie like The Counselor. And I think sometimes they even describe it as being just that. Shit. Just total shit. I've seen it on lists where they describe it as being one of his worst movies. I'm going to kind of go out on a limb here and say that there's two versions of his movies. Like many of the Ridley Scott movies, there seems to always be a theatrical version and then either an extended cut or a director's cut. And talk about one of these instances where a theatrical cut is different from a director's cut or an extended cut. This is one of these movies where I believe Ridley Scott actually does take ownership of the fact that the director's cut, extended cut, is his version of the movie. Like, the way that he actually envisioned the film should be. He also takes ownership of theatrical cuts because he is a man who is a businessman and knows that he needs to produce a product. But I will tell you that the theatrical cut is such a shit film. I remember I watched it the first time. I had rented it from Redbox and I was like, this is like a bit of a garbage movie, a bit of a throwback to these thrillers, these like scheming movies from the 1990s that it seemed like a poor man's version of doing a Coen Brothers film, which coincidentally, years later, the Coen Brothers would do a Cormac McCarthy book. You know, No Country for Old Men. So The Counselor is the first originally written for film, or however we want to describe it, that Cormac McCarthy wrote. It wasn't a book, it was just a screenplay. I've read a little bit of McCarthy's work, and although there are some overarching themes that he falls into, I with the exception of things like some of the violence or the eating babies, I've never kind of thought that some of his work would be so sleazy or so perverse. And that is, like, in a glorious way, The Counselor is such a sleazy movie. And I think Matchstick Men probably could have benefited from some of that sleaziness. It almost seemed like too slick of a movie. Like as if it was the time it came out, which is the early aughts, not being too rated R, but also trying to reach people on the sensibilities of being a heist movie or a crime film. Not letting Nicolas Cage go completely Cage out, because I don't think he had gotten there quite yet. He was still kind of seen as being like this movie star, kind of backseat sex symbol type, where, you know, you didn't want to make him look too gross. They gave him a, they gave him an eccentricity, which again was such a thing that they started doing in the aughts, where in around 2004, 2005, you started seeing these shows like House and Monk, where people had things like OCD or they were autistic, and that made them interesting because not only did they have all these weird tics, but they also used to say, you know, they also used to be a big pain in the ass and say what was on their mind. And, you know, yeah, there was, you know, it could rub people the wrong way, but hell, it made them interesting. But back to the counselor. So here we have, well, the counselor and Matchstick Men. So you have two movies that share a similar type of plot. There's a protagonist. They get involved in a scam, a scheme, a job, and it goes wrong. In Matchstick Men, I mean, it goes wrong. It goes wrong for him. You know, he had a little bit of a controlled life, and everything goes upend, and it goes wrong for him. And in The Counselor, it goes really wrong. And I mean, really wrong. You'll see it in the theatrical version, but if you can see the director's cut or the extended version or the unrated version, the unrated version, we'll just call it the director's cut. The director's cut is pretty damn good. Unless you just wanted to compare it, I don't know. I would probably say pass on the theatrical version of The Counselor. Just see the director's cut. It's not everyone's cup of tea. It is crude. It is sweaty. Maybe one of the sweatiest movies. It's not really violent, except that it contains a lot of pretty violent type of things in it. It also has an extremely graphic on-screen death. It's worth seeing the movie just for that. And for anyone who has seen Thelma and Louise, there's a line that Brad Pitt says in that movie about robbing a bank and what the people need to do to remain calm that I think pays off in this movie. It's about, you know, everybody behaving, keeping their cool, and not losing their head, or they are going to lose their head. So it's a sight to see. Javier Bardem in The Counselor tells two stories in it. One of them about his lady in it, played by Cameron Diaz, you'll hear, there's a line in the movie that says that he wished he could forget her fucking his car. And they physically show, you know, and that's, you know, this is 2022 right now, in a movie last year, which I'm gonna embarrass myself by if I pronounce it wrong, so I won't. So if you know the movie, it's about having sex with a vehicle, or you know, if you know the movie, you know what I'm talking about. so she has sex with a car, and there's some Transformers. see it. He also tells a great story about a guy who can barely speak English and how they give him some advice about picking up a woman at a club. And of course, if you ever had friends that were exchange students in high school, I'm sure that you at least even heard a story about some guys in high school who took, you know, Pierre or Victor or, you know, I'm trying to think of some names here. Some, I don't know, German exchange student, or maybe the exchange student who came from Vietnam or Japan, and you took them out someplace and you went to, you know, some club or something, and there was a girl and you're like, go over there, and you whisper in their ear what to tell them, and it is totally inappropriate. I'm not going to ruin it. I think it makes for a funny story. So watch the movie. It's great. It's a great little story that Bardem tells Fassbender about this guy. All right. I'm getting a little in the weeds with some of it, but Matchstick Men is enjoyable enough. It's, you know, looking back on it, because I had watched it recently, it doesn't exactly seem like a Ridley Scott movie. I think I kind of have an idea of what he tends to do now. But when I was thinking about trying to pair these movies up with duels, I thought that Matchstick Men and The Counselor at least had that connection of being two movies about deals gone wrong. And, you know, this is going to be a spoiler, so I'll give you a couple seconds if you don't want to listen to the rest of this right now. So I'm going to count to 10. Let's make it 5. 10's too long. So it goes bad for Nick Cage, who, you know, is a flim-flam man, a matchstick man, you know, a scam artist, as he puts it, an artiste. But the thing is that in the end, he's fine. His world is kind of ruined, but he's fine. Now, The Counselor, I think, is a much more enjoyable movie for how trashy it is. And I mean enjoyably trashy. There are critics that will fucking shit on this movie, but I watch it a lot. Even the theatrical cut, I think, is not that bad, but do watch the director's cut. There is a very interesting scene that goes on for, I think it's close to 5 minutes, with nearly no dialogue. And it's just about this guy setting up a trap. And that, I think, is a great example of what Ridley Scott does with visual storytelling. You know, the guy can be accused of having some movies that are, you know, too much world building and not enough world or not enough character. But what if the world is kind of more important than some of the characters? 'Cause the world is big. These are two, you know, modern films. I think some of his more, you know, period type movies have more atmosphere to them. So there's also a very myriad type of characters in The Counselor. A lot of actors show up. You'll see character actors from previous Scott movies that, you know, they show up for like one or two scenes. You know, everything from like one, two scene performances from people for like Rosie Perez and John Leguizamo. And I'm blanking on this actor's name, but he was in Kingdom of Heaven. And he was also in a couple other Scott movies. In Kingdom of Heaven, he plays Balian's like number two. Has a great scene where in Kingdom of Heaven where he says, you know, they must have terms. must offer terms, just because the battle's been going on so long, he wants this shit to end. So, the counselor. This is a little bit of a... me trying to have a little bit of redemption for the counselor, because I think that the director's cut of The Counselor is a fantastic movie. And it's a very deep and conflicted movie. And this is the film that he has coming out like after Prometheus. So my wife was listening to the little soundbite compilation I made. And I made a comment about it. I'm like, man, Ridley Scott has got like such an odd, like just eclectic mix of movies. It's, you never know what the hell is coming out next. I mean, to go from a movie like Prometheus to then doing a Cormac McCarthy like crime film that looks like a post Ridley Scott, Tony Scott movie from like 1999. It's just a little weird. Like you don't see a lot of changes in genre like that. Even with like Kubrick, who did, you know, he jumped from genre to genre. His style seemed to always kind of stay the same. I didn't say this in the last section when I was talking about the last duel about Alien and, The Martian, but that I don't think every one of Ridley Scott's movies are great, but I do think that he brings a lot of great things to them. And sometimes he's like, he has some really good highs and he has some very like disastrous lows. But I think even this movie, the Counselor, as a disastrous low, there is some great stuff to find in it. Interesting performances, some, you know, just kind of awesome scenes. It's written, it's written very scuzzy, very, very sweaty. Cameron Diaz is like, gives like a pretty damn good performance. It's kind of like a Lady Macbeth type. That's probably not the best way to describe her. Try to think of something a little more tragic. Euripides? I don't know. But that you get to the end of that movie and nobody's really okay. It's the world is like so gone to shit, and it's crazy. Like it's sometimes like you try to just try and find some happiness, and if you lose your way, you can lose your head. Or what's worse is that you're just left to live, and you have to be left to know what has happened and the awful things that you set into motion, which I guess that's probably one of the reasons why the movie kind of stays with me, is that it's the the sweet hereafter is not so sweet. I guess we're kind of getting back to this whole thing about dying alone, kind of like what we did with Alien and The Martian. And that's the big difference about a movie like Matchstick Men or The Counselor, is that one film is about dying alone and the other one is about getting off of the train and deciding to not die alone, taking that step toward something a little more, you know, getting out of the game. So even though Matchstick Men, I guess, has a happier ending, I am still going to say that the winner of this duel, ding ding, with their second by their side, is going to be the counselor. The director's cut of the counselor. Hell, I'd probably even give it to the theatrical cut of the counselor just because it's such a batshit insane movie. But the director's cut is very good. And it's well worth a watch. So that is our duel for now. And I will talk to you again later. Take care.
Particular reason that I could see, she slices off her knickers and hands them to me and gets out of the car. I asked her what she was doing, and she says, "I'm going to fuck your car."